Welcome, Sofia. So this looks fun. I mean, I'm sort of, this weekend I would normally go to Glastonbury. So I'm suffering terribly, I'm bereft. But this is a good substitute for this week. And of course, anyone else that would be going to Glastonbury next week. So this was filmed over 12 years. Did you sort of, for those people that don't know, this is sort of an area of Glastonbury that sort of became iconic, didn't it? And a festival within a festival.
Yeah, that was the whole kind of, you know, genesis of the film, and also of them as a party, as an area. You know, it sort of started in the southeast corner, which is now kind of called the naughty corner, which is where you've got Shangri-La and Block 9 and all of those kind of areas now sort of stemmed from Las Vegas, which was very much grew from the traveller movement of the 80s and 90s.
Yeah. So it's very much like, say, if you go to see Coldplay, you know, if you're desperate, and you're looking for something else to do afterwards, that was sort of like the after party area of Glastonbury, isn't it? Everyone just sort of left at the same time. Lots of queues, but once you got there, it's sort of like a magical area, isn't it?
Yeah, and I think it turned the face of Glastonbury around. So, you know, in the 90s, it was all about CND and, you know, the Greenpeace movement, which was brilliant, but it sort of lost its way a little bit. And then Las Vegas came, and at the turn of the century, you could suddenly put on a ball dress or, you know, go and play in a casino, which was such the antithesis of, you know, what had been there before. So it felt like something new and fresh. Obviously, you can do that in loads of festivals now, but these guys were the ones who were sort of doing it first.
So from a film director's point of view, were you just sort of there partying one night thinking, this will make a great film one day? How did it come about, the idea?
Sort of. I mean, I'd sort of, you know, the whole Britpop thing and the rave culture, which I was sort of part of, it was very kind of asexual and aesthetically quite bland, wasn't it? You know, I think most people agree with that. And then I stumbled upon Las Vegas sort of in 2000 and went, wow, this is like completely different. You know, this is, and the main thing I thought I was going to make a film about was the women. You know, there was this kind of overt sexuality and kind of reclaiming of that sexuality very publicly. And I thought that was really, really exciting. So I thought I was going to make a film about women. I didn't think that it was going to take 12 years and I would make this film about this man, crazy man.
Yes, let's talk about Roy Gervitt. So he's the creator of Las Vegas. So what was he like? Sounds like quite a character.
Him and lots of other people. It's always really important to say that because it was such a kind of collective. But, you know, he started out as a kind of nice Jewish boy in, you know, northwest London, and then just pretty much ran away with the circus. We tried to talk about the nature of creativity and how that can either get the better or worst of you as well.
Okay. You filmed this over 12 years, so a real labour of love. But also during that time, I guess you got involved, got your hands dirty, so to speak. So you must have seen some sides. What are some of the highlights from making the film and just being in that scene, in that area of Glastonbury?
Yeah, I mean, you know, there was highlights as well as sort of challenges, but they always make stories, don't they? I remember one time we were doing like a secret gig. So we had to go and pick Suggs up, but nobody knew where his was, including his manager. So we drove across the site, which was like this deep in mud. And we eventually found him in like a ditch, and he had like this crazy wig on and he was covered in mud.
I work for the radio station there, you know, and we're not allowed to tweet anything out about it because, you know, the rumours spread in Glastonbury quite quickly. Fatboy Slim, local hero obviously to Brighton, he's made an appearance in the film. Who else is in the film that we might know?
Yeah, so Norman comes in a bumblebee outfit, which was something that he'd always wanted to do, he says in the film, and felt that the only place he could do it was Las Vegas. So that was a liberating moment in his history. As I said before, madness. There's quite a lot with Keith Allen, actor Keith Allen, because he was a regular in the field. And then there's like maybe slightly more unexpected people like Wayne Hemingway, the Red or Dead designer. And one other person who I've just totally forgotten. But there's loads of kind of characters that pop up in the film all the way through.
So for people that are missing Glastonbury next week, you've got the film tomorrow night at the Old Market. What time's it all kicking off? Because you've got the film and then you've actually got a lot of the people that are involved in Las Vegas with the after party as well.
Yeah. So local to Brighton, the two Wrongies who do naked synchronized swimming, they were regulars at Las Vegas. So they'll be performing their act. There'll be some DJs from the casino and this kind of amazing, they weren't in Las Vegas, but they're very much the style, Tempe piece sort of shakedown gospel band called The Future Shape of Sound. So it's quite a lot to pack in. We kick off at 7:30 and then, yeah, we've got acts, bands and DJs and a bit of a party.
Sounds great. And tickets are available on the Old Market website. Okay, lovely. Sophia, it's great to talk to you. I feel a bit better that I'm missing Glastonbury now. Yeah. And good luck with the film.
Thank you.